Moorland, Somerset. An English village like any other. But last year, this quite ordinary place had an extraordinary experience. It was the wettest winter in 250 years. Storms brought misery to large parts of the country, but nowhere was worse hit than the Somerset Levels.
We've lost everything. I've lost my house, I've lost my family, I've lost everything.
In the space of 24 hours, people's homes and lives were washed away.
That's it. We've officially lost it all.
The area was inundated with dignitaries, and politicians promised to bring help to the stricken villagers.
Money will be no object. I don't want people to worry about penny pinching as they see the vital work that's needed to help them with their houses, to help them deal with the floods.
But when the media interest ebbed away, the villagers were left to rebuild their homes and their lives.
I spent 4 years renovating this place and now let's start again.
We follow them as they cope with the stress and strains of dealing with builders and insurance companies.
The insurance will not pay for nothing. They have not given us anything.
Oh, God.
But we discover the floodwaters have left a residue of bitterness and despair.
You people have been saying dredging the river is not going to make any difference at all. Complete and utter rubbish.
No one is telling us the truth. You pulled a plug.
We did not pull anything.
And will they be able to rebuild their lives and find happiness again?
Yep. Happy tears.
A bit better. A bit better now.
It's the 6th of February, and the villagers are valiantly fighting to save their homes. People like Phil and Lana Smithen.
Preoccupied with just desperately trying to stem this flow of water. Managed to get hold of two pumps that we were using, and it was desperate, actually.
This morning I got up and I felt sick, physically sick. Mm. Yesterday I was just shaking all day. I couldn't stop shaking.
Yeah.
Sorry.
The water was just overwhelming us.
Yeah. The water is coming through that area and that area there.
Phil's a retired head teacher. Lana, a school secretary.
In our wildest dreams, did not ever envisage over a metre of water coming straight through the downstairs of our home.
Once the rain stopped, the village stood in polluted water for 6 weeks. As one of the lowest-lying areas of the country, the Somerset Levels rely on an intricate system of man-made drains, ditches, rivers and pumps to keep them above water. Faced with one of the wettest winters on record, the existing pumps couldn't remove the water fast enough. The Environment Agency brought in extra pumps, but some villagers believe that their efforts were too little, too late.
This is just unbelievable. What I cannot get out of my mind is the fact that it could have been avoided. Yes, we could have had some floods, but not on this scale. If the Environment Agency had shown some responsibility in terms of, and got their priorities right, it's an absolute disgrace, quite honestly. And heads should be rolling over this, and things should be done. Ugh.
Oh. The rural communities of Moorland and Fordgate are made up of a church, a village hall, and 148 homes. 120 were severely flooded. The surrounding farms were also overwhelmed by the deluge. Mary and Brian Hutchins have lived and bred dairy cattle here all their lives.
We rang up the NFU to see where the animals, if there was any space on other farms for the animals to go. Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, we were busy all day and every day moving out animals. Your first instinct is animal welfare. As literally as that. Got a nephew at North Kerry, he kindly took the young yearlings, what we call the calves that have grown up for a year, and he's taken those, all those. And we've got another nephew down at Cannington, and his wife, she absolutely loves Frisians, and she took on my babies.
Mary and Brian had to be persuaded to leave their farm.
Policeman come in, me and Brian was having breakfast. He said, Mary and Brian, you cannot stay in here. Sat in 2 foot of water. And we said, well, we've got another load to go, and that's it. Then the electric went. He said, well, that's it. He said, you can't now. We said, no, we got to wait for those animals to go first.
When Mary and Brian finally returned to their farm, they found a scene of devastation.
Hello, Dinky. It's a good girl. It's on the side of the door. Here, look, you can see how high it's come up. Would that be about 2.5, 3 feet? Up to there. So that was underwater.
I'm sure some people would have looked at this and thought, it's time to put up my feet and do something else.
When we came back, I suspect it was about the second day, a neighbour came to us. Are you back for good? We said, yes. Oh, thank the Lord for that, he said. We've all said this will finish Mary and Brian. And we said, no, not us.
Maria and Philip May bought their dream home 4 years ago for over £300,000.
Look at it.
Phil's a retired major in the Royal Engineers.
Oh, God. That's worse than I thought.
They returned in March to find their house in ruins.
Give me strength, God.
It's a sad day to come back in here 6 weeks later. Very sad. Can't talk about it. I can't.
Oh, dear God.
It's just sort of furniture, and it's not the furniture, it's the little things. The little things that you're missing, like diaries, photographs. It's gone.
This low-lying area of the country has a system to cope with flooding. When water levels are high, the rivers overflow into the moors, which act as a vast sponge to store water until it can be pumped away. But last winter, the moors were already saturated. Overwhelmed by the unprecedented rain, they flooded the communities on their fringes.
They're from yesterday, but...
Some villagers believe that more could have been done to protect their homes, and they set up a campaign organisation, the Flooding on the Levels Action Group, or FLAG.
London too many rabbits.
Bryony Sadler's a leading player in flag. She's a mother of two and runs a hairdressing business.
He's got
bare feet.
Her husband Gavin, a graphic designer, set up the group.
This is our rental property that we moved to as a long-term rental, and basically, you know, until we needed to go home. Elsa, we can't go in a two up, two down because we've got so many animals and there's so many of us. So it had to be a little bit larger.
Oh, naughty chickens!
I don't think Topsy and Tim have laid any recently.
Back in February, the Sadlers took the precaution of evacuating their home and taking the children to a place of safety. It was from there that they got the news they dreaded, that their property had flooded.
If you look, sort of, if you step across from the conservatory, oh, I don't want to know. Wait, what?
It is surrounded by water now.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Okay, bye.
Bye. They've blocked the road off because they're trying to get the cows out and my horse. And then when they've done that, then the Environment Agency are going to Plan C, whatever Plan C is. But I've had to have the police people go in and turn my oil and my boiler off, and that's it. We've officially lost it all.
Daddy pushed up that bunk
there. Daddy put all those things up on there.
So they
don't get ruined, you're right.
To be inundated with water and dirty water, the muck off the fields, and then of course we're all on septic tanks, so it's all human waste as well. Where do you start?
No, they're all right. There's nothing under them. I checked them this morning. Where's Janet? Oh, Janet's hiding.
Since then, they've been living out of boxes whilst trying to earn a living and keep family life on track.
How are you finding it, being homeless?
Stressful. Because, you know, you've got here to look after, and then we've got to look after home, because obviously we want to go home with it looking how it did. So you've got to do the gardening here and the gardening there, and, you know, project managing your own life and dealing with a disaster and running two businesses. It's an absolute nightmare.
Mid-March, the waters have receded, leaving behind a trail of debris. A massive clear-up operation is being undertaken, and volunteers from across the country have come to help the people of Moorland. The villagers are scattered across Somerset. Only a handful have returned, like Maria May and her husband Phil, and are living in caravans near their properties while their homes are uninhabitable. As if the flood wasn't enough, today Maria's had some news from her insurer.
It actually just says that the final decision was made to void our policy on the 24th of February. That's when they actually voided the policy, and they're definitely sticking by that.
Because they failed to declare this drain near their house, their insurance won't be paying them a penny. With no payout, it means that Maria and Phil will have to fund the work on their house themselves. But the volunteer army have stepped in to lend a hand.
Yeah, you can strip off all you want.
I never told him that.
Look at them, it'll be even nicer than what it was before, Phil.
I spent 4 years renovating this place and then I'll start again. So, yeah, hey ho.
So why is this area so difficult to keep dry? The answer lies in the history. The Somerset Levels were once covered by the sea. It made an ideal home for monks who chose to live an isolated life, and it was here that the great monasteries of Glastonbury, Athelney and Muchelney were built upon islands in this watery wilderness. It was the monks who began the vast job of reclaiming the land and turning it to agricultural use. Over the centuries, flood defences have been improved with huge investment in man-made rivers, waterways and pumping stations.
To fight the menace of the floods, vast drainage schemes are in progress. Typical examples are those near Bridgewater in Somerset.
These efforts have dramatically reduced flooding. But the man-made system can be overwhelmed, and it needs constant maintenance. The Environment Agency stopped routinely dredging the rivers here more than 10 years ago, and dismissed claims that desilting would prevent flooding. But the unprecedented floods led to a U-turn. 8 weeks later, work commenced on the River Parrot.
Take Teddy up the path. Please be careful with him.
It's a victory for Bryony and the campaign group, who believe that increasing the flow and capacity of the rivers will reduce the risk of flooding.
This is the bit that's been identified as the worst area. So this is, in total, it'll be 8 kilometres that they should be doing. They've got until the end of October. They're gonna have to ramp it up because at the moment it's not good enough. It's too slow. And jump, house! Jump, jump! 3-year-olds can't explain. You know, she just gets up in the middle of the night and wets the bed. Very upset and wanting to go home, but of course at the moment we can't go home because there's no downstairs.
It's April and the village is uninhabited while the properties dry out. Phil and Lana's insurance is paying out, but it's still a long and painful process. The house is being emptied and cleaned.
It's just the daunting task of knowing who's going to be coming, who we need to phone, who, you know, we need to talk to. It's just overwhelming, really. It's just tearing our lives apart, really, because we've been here 40 years and we built this house up and it's just tearing it all apart.
There's frustration at Mary and Brian's farm too. They've had to keep their cattle indoors since the water destroyed their fencing.
They should have been out 6 weeks, 2 months ago, if it wasn't for the floods, and they would have been happier and healthier. And we would have been straighter. But the frustration is enormous for us and them. It's so nice to see them go out in the summer. And the first day out we've had for years, we've had, when we used to milk the cows, the old granny that couldn't move, you open the gate and let her out. She'll show you she can move. There we go. Right, putting up this extra white tape with electric in it so that they can see it easy, hopefully, so they won't jump over on the way out through to the next field. He's round checking the fence that the electric's going all the way around the field now. Got to make sure it comes back at this end. Then we can open the gate down there in the shed, and then they should, fingers crossed, come out here, skip and go down across the field into the next one. We hope.
Mary, like many people in the village, feel that the authorities let them down.
The waters came in unbelievably fast. I'm sorry, but if they cannot manage water management any better than that, why are they doing the job that they're doing? I strongly believe, and I know hundreds of other people do the same, it's not the chaps on the ground. They are doing a brilliant job and they've got to work hard in order to do their job. It's the ones higher up in the little ivory towers that think they know everything, and I'm sorry, but they know nought. They've been told year after year it's not working, but will they listen? No, we know best. Well, I sincerely hope this has proved that they have realised they do not know best.
The pumps are in place. We just need to tart it up a little bit. So obviously the flooring, what's going down here?
John Rowlands is the Environment Agency's Flood and Coastal Risk Management team leader.
So new plaster?
Today he's at the pumping station, which protects Moorland. He's become the face of an organisation some villagers detest.
Because the wall does look a bit... Is this where the water came in? The egress?
The Environment Agency insist they did all they could to protect Moorland, but some residents don't believe them.
Those responsible for taking the decisions which led to this catastrophe, they need to account for themselves. They need to spell out what the theory was behind it, what they hoped to achieve.
It would be fair to say that we did our level best to try and get that water away as quickly as we could. It was just such an unprecedented event that it was way off our scale of understanding, certainly when it comes to levels of flooding.
Somerset is special. To me, it's very, very special, and I think we need to do our level best to try and keep it as special as we can.
But some villagers continue to believe that Moorland was sacrificed to save the larger towns downstream.
The unanswered question that just keeps haunting me is the fact that last year, of course, we had severe flooding. Only one or two houses in the village were affected. This year, and we end up with a village that's completely underwater. Something happened. That wasn't just rainfall that caused that overnight. They moved water from one place to another, and a huge quantity of water as well, and sacrificed us.
John Rowlands is on a campaign to convince the villagers that the flood was not man-made.
Hell, let's just get them in and be safe.
We're trying to deal with the situation. Some people would say not well enough, and fine, I accept that. But hopefully these events will try and explain how the agency works and how do they wish to be treated in the future. We have to understand the feelings that the people who are flooded who have been impacted by flooding, how they feel.
I'm not a happy man. and I will remain very, very cross until we get some answers in terms of what happened and why it happened, and of course what they're planning to do in the future with regard to safeguarding us.
Bye!
John Rowlands is running a tour for villagers to win back hearts and minds.
So now we're onto the River Tone. Whether we like it or not, this is an absolute haven for water voles. To enable us to do the work, we've had to trap them and move them on.
And where have we moved them to?
They've gone on holiday.
They'll be back soon.
It's a long way to come from Hampshire. But we have such a good population here that they literally, we've moved the excess away.
How much money does that cost to do that?
Let's put it like this.
It's not in the dredge, that's fine.
Without moving those, the dredge would not have taken place.
Oh, for Christ's sake. Now I've heard it all.
And the hairy
I've heard it all as well.
The final stop is Currymore Pumping Station. And it's a chance to air the grievances that have festered since the floods.
But you will see at the back here, there are some more pumps, some big white pumps. These were bought in 2006, and they take out about 1 cubic metre of water per second. There are two of those. These pump out about 5, 7, 7.5, and we have the facility to bring more pumps in as we did last time.
Can I just make a point?
Yes.
Are you talking about moving water from place to place? How come we get nothing last year in terms of flooding? This year, we came down to 1.2 metres of filthy water completely engulfing our ground floor. And that happened over a day.
Yeah.
That wasn't, water must have been moved to have caused that. Don't shake your head, because it must have been. Moved.
Absolutely, categorically deny that accusation. There is no structure that we magically turn or push a button on. There's none of that.
We could rest a bit better next year if somebody just said to us, sorry, we just made a mistake.
Yeah.
We've got this hanging over us now for the next umpteen years,
it's
so
horrible.
We die.
It's
and,
horrible.
You know, it's horrible. We've got stress you wouldn't believe. And we've still got stress to come. Because no one is telling us the truth. You pulled a plug, and we know it. I don't care what you say, and that is it.
I've said to you already, I will not lie to you. We did not pull anything. There is nothing to pull. Okay, all I can say to you is that the water that came through Taunton on that February morning was the same size in volume as you experienced in 2000. Now, in 2000, the moors were empty. So therefore, the water that came down went into that moor. Last year, the moor was full when we had that.
We have to accept that people will make accusations. It is very much in the heat of the moment. In due course, when things have settled down a little bit, we can answer those accusations, and I'm hoping that what they get from me will be the truth. I have no need to tell people lies. I have no need to embellish things. Hopefully they will win my trust in due course when I tell them something that actually it is what it is.
It's June, 3 months since the floods, and Moorland is still quiet. Most of the 120 flooded homes are still drying out. But there's activity going on at Maria's house. The insurance company refused to pay out, but ironically, they're now on track to be the first family to move back home in the village.
I tell you what, as nice as this sink is, but my back kills me. Every morning, every lunchtime, every tea time.
How long have you been living in the caravan?
3 months. 3 months? It's unbelievable. 3 months it's been.
The Mays have had a bit of good news. A building company stepped in to help uninsured flood victims, and they've offered all their labour for free.
I feel extremely lucky. It might sound awful, with my insurance being voided. I now feel the lucky one to have my house probably, or is happening, ready before somebody else's who has got insurance. Because they're waiting for, the insurance to come through, they have to choose their builders, they have to wait for estimates, they have to do all these things. I didn't have to do all that.
But their life's possessions are still stacked up in their shed.
It breaks my heart, it really does. It's going to be another day of sadness to find out what's got shoved under here. It's amazing, it's the first time I've done this. Oh, dear God. My sewing box. Little sentimental things like that, you know? You think, why? Why do they take things away from us? That's gone, you can't repair that. It's all rusty and...
Despite the Environment Agency's effort to show that the flood was nature-made, their explanation was not accepted.
I'm still very, very angry about it. I can't seem to say, oh, well, it's happened, we'll forgive you, let's not do it again. No, I can't do that.
The work at Phil and Lana's house is being paid for by their insurer, but progress feels painfully slow.
It has come to a little bit of a halt because we were hoping to have got in by August, but I can't see it now until October at the latest, or the earliest, I should say. So, yeah, it's a little bit frustrating. I haven't been that well, I must admit. Sorry. No, there's some days I just couldn't come over. It was just too much. I have been to the doctors about it, and I've had a really bad skin condition, and I just didn't know what it was. And they put it down to stress.
Phil and Lana bought their house as a wreck in 1974 for £6,000. They brought up their two children here.
It was and is very precious.
And
to
it
us.
Is very precious to us, and we've looked after it, and as it has looked after us as well, because we saved this house in the beginning. It was condemned. No one would give us a mortgage for it, but we knew we could do something with it. We were only young, we were only in our 20s.
We worked very, very, very hard on it. We actually went for 10 years without any kind of holiday.
We didn't have a holiday.
Because we didn't have any money. It's not just a home to us. It's very precious to us.
Local farmers are suffering too. But before Mary and Brian can rebuild, they have to demolish.
Going all through this, and it's a bit trying and this and that, but at the end we'll have a nice new setup. This is the final come down. After that, it's build up, you know?
Yeah, that's it. I've no doubt we shall get there.
Yeah.
Mary and Brian were born here in Somerset. Back in the 1950s, they were keen members of the Young Farmers. They met in their early 20s at the Chard Agricultural Show dance.
Dance with one or two, like you did back then. And then Brian came over. Oh, this is different. And straight away, that was it. It was as instant as that. And ever since then, we've built everything together.
By early July, the builders are back in nearly every home in the village.
What's happening?
But at Rose Cottage, the rebuild is already over.
Isn't anybody here yet?
Today, Maria gets her house back.
Oh.
It's 5 months since the Mays left their flooded home.
Do you remember? All his plaster came off, and that one with her mum.
It's a chance to thank all the volunteers who helped the couple rebuild their home.
Now, I know a lot of you are here today, and from the bottom of our hearts, we'd like to thank each and every one of you, because we couldn't have done it on our own, we couldn't be where we are, and we're so far ahead of the game compared to a lot of poor people that are insured, that are having a hell of a job with their loss adjusters. We just want to say thank you very much.
Yeah.
How are you doing? Okay. You happy now?
Yes. Happy
tears.
Better
now.
At the old rectory, it's a different story. Although Bryony Sadler's insurance are paying up, there's a major problem.
It's just all massively unacceptable at the moment. You know, our life is imploding. Big time.
Why? What's happening?
Since you guys were last here, we've had builders for a week, but the insurance company is now not paying. They've pulled all the funding for us. Because the loss adjuster has put our rebuild at about 100,000. Well, it's coming at 183. You know, there's people in the village that were the uninsured that have gone home. The people who are insured and have got reasonable people helping them to get home are nearly home, and ours hasn't even bloody started, so. And then this is the rest of the house.
Bryony and Gavin bought their house in 2002 for £330,000. They renovated the property together to create their dream home.
I wish to God we weren't actually insured. Because then we would have had the volunteers do it for us and we would be home. Rather than sitting like this. This is real life on the Somerset Levels. You know, I've worked tirelessly to get the rivers dredged. Well, they're being dredged. Can I get home? No. It is a massive mess.
It's high summer, and the villagers are still scattered to the winds. It's a concern for Jane Haslam, the vicar of Moorland.
I think it just throws everything you know. You know, there are, in a job like this and every other job, there are routines that you get used to and common requests that you know how to respond to. But something like this just totally throws you, really.
As Jane's flock has been scattered far and wide, she's organising a summer party to bring them back together.
Oh, they'll love that.
It's the first time the village has gathered as a community since the floods.
looking at the eating estate. He's feeling. Do you like Stefan or not?
They've said to me, look, do you live near a drain? And if I knew there was a drain, I would have said yes.
Yes.
But I didn't.
Yes.
I had no yes. idea. Yeah. So, but they didn't even consider my honesty and say, look, we'll come round and give you something. Nothing.
They didn't bother. Is it true that they tried to repay your premium?
They have paid our premium for 4 years. Woo! Hello!
If you don't have insurance, you get your house fixed,
yeah.
And you can move back now.
And you're back now for the summer holidays.
You're back for the summer.
With the kids.
If you pay out your insurance,
yeah.
You have to then wait
that's
6
it.
Months
for
before
rental.
They even do anything.
You can't even, yeah.
So tell me how that's right.
Yeah. It's not right. It's not
so,
right.
So what's the point of having insurance?
The party that we had last week for like Maria and everything coming back, it was such a bittersweet.
Oh yeah.
I went home and I cried. I cried because I thought I'm so happy for Maria. Because she's doing what I would give my back teeth to have her kids back in the village for the summer holidays.
Every day, the builders are working in the village 8 till 5. And Phil and Lana make a daily pilgrimage to check up on progress.
This is our normal lunch every day.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's in the middle of the building works, but today it's a lovely day, so.
God, those tomatoes are lovely.
We'll have to continue having rolls, I think, every day, because we'll be so used to them now.
We are hardwired for rolls now.
And there's some news in the village. A family have sold up at half price, but one person's misfortune is another's opportunity.
This is normally the bit where you start swearing.
A new family's moving in.
For us, it was an ideal opportunity to look at buying something that we've always wanted.
Rachel Selway and Peter Lane were attracted by the space and rural lifestyle for their young family.
We are excited. I'm looking forward to getting all my livestock and just having a country life existence. So, yeah.
They're adapting the house to withstand future floods.
We'll have very basic furniture in the house. And then hopefully with all the notice that you'll get, we can start lifting it up in the barns and getting it out of level. And we're going to set it higher than the water went this time. So obviously they said it was catastrophic this year, the volume that came through. So we can only do as much as we can. Nature will be nature.
And last year, nature did wreak havoc. Their house was the most severely flooded in the village. Bryony Sadler has finally persuaded her insurance company to pay up.
It's just bashing your head against a brick wall the whole time. And, like, you know, this wasn't meant to happen. You know, they were meant to be playing ball and doing whatever we wanted, because at the end of the day, it wasn't our fault and it wasn't our water. And I will carry on saying that till my dying day.
Every time I come back, I look at that poor, sorry mess and wonder what's going on.
Every week, Bryony meets with her loss assessor. It's his job to manage the work and liaise with the insurance company. There are problems inside.
That's being moved. You want that over to the right, don't you? This part here. Correct
yes,
or not?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. That's going over on Saturday.
Right.
So they're moving that over on Saturday.
But the biggest problem is future-proofing the house against flooding.
Did we find somebody else to lay the flooring?
No, I've spoken to three carpenters, or wood flooring specialists, and it was all highlighted in that email.
Where do we end with this? Just sit and wait?
How did you fit the last time?
Gav.
Do you want to do it again?
Yes, he would do it again. It's just not how it ought to be anymore. You know, we want to come home, and
everything's come back at us. The water wasn't our fault. The mess in our homes isn't our fault. You know, the argument with the paint, the argument with the tiles, the oil tank, the wood flooring, it always comes back down to us, and it's just so negative all the time. There's no, you know, you have one tiny piece of positive followed by 4,000 pieces of negative, and oh, you sort it out.
I know how annoyed you are and everything about it, but it's just, I can't. It's something that's completely out of my control.
I need to hit something.
It's autumn, and it's harvest time on the levels. The land reclaimed from ancient marshes has provided a bountiful harvest for decades. It's an annual ritual for people to gather together. This year, it's all a bit different.
It's very strange, isn't it, Mary, that we have to do these in someone's garden this year,
yes,
instead of having it in the village hall, isn't it, Margaret?
Yes.
And we don't have, also, we're going to be missing the lovely auction of all the goodies that normally we have. You know, it's not going to be there this year because nobody's got anything growing, no gardens. What time is the service, Margaret?
Five,
what time's
five.
The start? I'm gone, one pickle onion on there, they're not done, these are.
Because the village hall was so badly flooded, this year it's al fresco.
How are you getting on with your house, Mary?
Not so good, Margaret.
Not so good.
No, we have subsidence now they've discovered.
Oh, God.
So they've got to dig right down, all round. Kitchen floor is going to come totally up, right out, because it's cracked right across.
Shush!
Harvest loaf?
Harvest loaf? Here. Yeah? I got a better one than that. I didn't bring it in. I didn't, because I bought it because we didn't have enough loaves, but we've got plenty of loaves. But I've got a big cottage loaf.
Okay, we'll have that as well.
Do you want that as well?
I'll take my little one away. I made that this afternoon.
Well, good. That's all right then, that's what we'll do. That's what we'll do. I forgot to bring
it. Doesn't matter, cheers.
Back in your old shed?
No, we are hoping for mid-October.
Right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to have a lovely harvest celebration and then enjoy a feast together. And we know it's not what we usually do, but it's still lovely to gather together in this community and celebrate God's goodness and his blessings at this harvest time.
We love
Despite not being back in their homes, the age-old sense of community appears to have survived the floods.
It's just like songs of praise, isn't it, really?
It's wonderful to see the village all together because I think we've got a unique community spirit in this village. Everybody's very friendly and very supportive of one another, would you agree?
Yeah.
And, you know, to come together on such an occasion is great.
The change of seasons a cause for concern. October brings more rain. At Batten's farm, demolition has finished, but rebuilding hasn't begun. Mary and Brian are still living in a caravan, but they're far more concerned about their animals' living quarters.
We're not in a proper routine. We can't see to things. It's very difficult the same. Makes it harder work. Never mind. We keep hoping we're getting there. But we're just hoping and praying these buildings will come now. Because we've got nowhere to bring the animals into.
It must be a little bit of a worry, all of this.
Little bit. Huge worry. Yeah. Yeah. We just haven't got to stop and think about it. It's very easy to go under.
It's November, 9 months since the floods. Most of the people are now home, and finally the saddlers are returning too.
There's going to be a lot of unpacking later. There's 7 months worth of stuff there, and that's only a half of what we've got to fit back into the home, so yeah, I'm glad I've split it over 2 days. Nice to see it home, though.
And the future brings new challenges on the horizon. Some people have faced crippling bills to renew their insurance, and all of them have seen the value of their houses plummet.
Big problems now are we going to get house insurance in January? If we refused, what the hell do we do with our mortgage? Are we then going to get repossessed? That is the next three things that are going to come out of this. People are going to get their houses repossessed, I'm guessing, because we can't get insurance. Nobody wants to touch us with a barge pole. You know, then if you've got no insurance, your mortgage is invalid. Well, if your mortgage is invalid, then surely people are going to start losing their homes, and that's outrageous. My ideal life is luckily ideal, but I'm going to be stuck in it for the entirety because it's worthless now, because people don't want to buy houses down here.
Hello!
Becky!
Hello! What's this? Working hard in numeracy, multiplying 2 by 1-digit numbers. Ooh. Excellent. Hello! Helen's Forest School!
No, look, Daddy!
Oh, what have you got? You got a superstar award for being helpful and kind. Well done! Hey, guys. Hey, guys. Welcome home.
Oh, that's a nice kid. Mummy, go up
there. Yeah, just let Daddy take his boots off.
Yes, it's amazing to be home, but how long are we going to be here? Where do we go if we need to come back out again this winter? Well, hopefully this winter they're not going to let it happen, but 5 years down the line we can easily be left. And where do we go next time? Well, by a boat. Who knows?
The new couple are planning for exactly that scenario. They bought their house and land at auction in July.
We are preparing for the water to come through again. My brother's helping us put a second floor up in the barn, mainly so we can put a higher level up, higher than the floodwaters came through in February. And we can put all of our belongings up, and we can then know that everything should, in theory, be safe, be dry. We don't have flood insurance, so we need to be thinking sensibly and keep everything as much as we can safe.
We don't flood as a bonus, but I'd say we probably will.
And we're prepared.
But some of the families are having difficulties adjusting. The Mays were the first to move home in July. But for Maria, what makes a perfect home has changed.
It doesn't feel like home, although we have our own little things around us. But what we had and is travelled with us all our lives is gone. The memory is gone and the house doesn't feel right. I don't feel happy. I really would like to move. I don't think people are happy. They all have new homes. They all have, you know, their homes has been refurbished, revamped or whatever. We all have. But is it really home? No, I don't think so. It's going to take a while before I could call this home. And I don't want to call it home. I don't like it.
But Phil and Lana, who've lived in their house for more than 40 years, are just happy to be home.
It's lovely to be back in your own home, obviously.
Even if we haven't got anything.
Even if we haven't got any furniture at the moment. It's a bit of a squat, is this?
Yes, so we're going to be squatting for about 2 weeks.
It's a happy squat.
Yeah. We're going to be camping out for the next fortnight, I expect, till all our furniture comes back, but I don't care. We're home, that's all it is.
And in the village that we're very, very fond of. And amongst neighbours that we're very, very fond of. There we are, my dear.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Hope it's never going to happen again.
No. Mwah. Back doors are locked, are they?
Yep.
Right.
This is our home. This is where we want to be. We don't want to be anywhere else. And we're going to be here forever.
We have no plans on moving.
No. They will carry me out in a box.
What's missing?
As 2014 ends, the people of Moorland can look back on a tumultuous year, and 32 families still haven't moved back home.
Ready? How's it look? Yay!
New pumps have been installed, the rivers have been dredged, and the waterways are coping well with the current rainfall. But it's always at the back of people's minds that the floods could return again.